Goro gets you excited to see Goro. Because yeah. the entire time, he's got his forearms in the air going, just screaming at everybody. It's like, we get it, Goro. You're hyped, dude.
Hey everybody, and welcome to the second episode of Popcorn and Shield, the only show with access to the full Warner Brothers film archives, showing you the latest and greatest hit films of all time and some gems that you may have missed and overlooked along the way. I hope you haven't, but maybe you did. I'm one of your co-hosts, Elise Willems, and joining me today, pulled to the outworld, much like the heroes of some movies we're going to be talking about today, are Alfredo Diaz. What's up, Alfredo?
It's gonna be so good.
And Blaine Gibson. Hey, Blaine.
Hello. Can you guys call me Blaino? I actually trimmed my beard to look like Kano.
Oh, you did.
I mean, you did
a little
though.
Bit. Hold on.
Oh, Blaino.
Oh my goodness. All right. I have no idea what he's doing. Is he gonna blind himself?
It didn't fall out. It worked earlier.
What the? You grabbed like the heaviest ball.
I knew when Blaine said before this, he was like, what? Yeah, I might have a little bit or something. There was something telling us.
I had no idea.
I've dressed as a Mortal Kombat character before. So many people might not know this, but we all work at Rooster Teeth and we work in gaming there. Funhouse, Achievement Hunter. We're making gaming content, Let's Plays, among other things. And I've participated in a Funhouse Mortal Kombat tournament where I was very proud to represent Goro and his many arms and many fighting skills. Lost, of course, but, you know.
Yeah, talk about old Mortal Kombat content. I guess there was, like, years ago I did a short where it was, like, I think it was Scorpion's Dojo. It was, like, a family fitness center run by Scorpion. And that was like one of my favorite shorts. That was so cool.
That's great. You directed that?
Yeah. I think I wanted to do a sequel where it was Sub-Zero's frozen yogurt, but we never got around to it. Maybe after this, Warner Brother will give us the money, I'm sure.
Yeah. I mean, Achievement Hunter, we play a ton of video games, not well. So Mortal Kombat is also one of those games that we play not well. And let me tell you, I'm real good at just holding down on the analog stick and just a little kick, just a little chip damage, just a pop, pop, pop.
Oh, you're griefing? You griefing out there?
Not on purpose. Spamming a button. Look, I play FPS games. That's like my bread and butter. But fighting games, the whole like Z motion or like the half C, I can't do it. I can't.
No.
I don't know.
The quarter circle forward.
My thumbs don't function like that. It confuses me.
Yeah, I have to say.
If we gave you one of those big board things, then maybe, you know.
I think I do better on the actual fight sticks.
Yeah, that's why, like, nobody knows what they're talking about. Blaine's like, the board thing.
The board
thing. And Alfredo's like, I kind of move the joystick a little bit. Nobody knows. Which is, I guess, makes sense because I respect the video games, but it's the movie, specifically the OG, which I bow down to.
So if it hasn't been made plainly clear, we're going to be talking about the OG video game movie, Mortal Kombat. And it's good stuff. It's known for fatalities, for Johnny Cage, for really good music. That's like the big one.
Practical effects and some cutting edge CG?
We could say, sure, we could say that.
You know, the time, it was mind blowing. Yes.
Oh, yeah. Goro looked amazing. There was shots where I was watching and I was like, how do they do Goro?
Look, he's like, a puppet.
A lot of oil. A lot of baby oil went into the Goro-like prop. But before we start, be sure to subscribe to the channel to know when new episodes come out, because next we'll be talking about the Batman animated series. Come on!
Everybody's got to show off their stuff.
I mean, I got Batman stuff right behind. But it's the Batman animated series. That's, oh my good, Mark Hamill.
I was
the Joker.
Raised on, I mean, that dude.
That's what I grew up watching. Okay, so we'll be talking about that, that animated series and films, you know, featuring Batman Long Halloween. And there's a ton of stuff on the Warner Brothers Entertainment channel. So make sure to stick around and check all that stuff out.
Yeah, and unless Blaine has any more prop work or anything,
and this is where Blaine does the splits.
Hold on. I'm Johnny Cage now. Huh?
Oh, there you go.
Yeah.
Oh. Hollywood.
Okay, I'm done with the props. No more props.
I think we can finally talk some fatalities, which are a big part of the new kid on the block in the Mortal Kombat franchise, which is 2021's Mortal Kombat. And everybody's seen it, right?
Yes. Yeah. It was like watching the original, but like from the perspective of today. It's just like there was like nostalgia, but it was also like, oh, they updated this. It's more modern now.
Yeah, I mean, I saw it because the movie just dropped on HBO Max the other day. And I mean, legitimately super excited to watch this just because, I mean, who wasn't hyped for the trailer? You know, like when the trailer dropped, like within the first like minute of the trailer, you see Sub-Zero and Jax fighting, and then Sub-Zero grab Jax's arms, ice them down, and then break them off. And it sat there and went, oh, this, it's going to be this kind of Mortal Kombat movie. Like, this is what you want to see. Like, you want to see, you know, fatalities and brutalities, and you don't want the camera pulling away from those scenes, going, cutting the black and just hearing a scream in the distance or anything like that. So the trailer really set the tone, and so that's why I was just so excited to watch this movie and see what they were going to do with this franchise.
To be clear with the audience, we're not going to get into spoilery stuff. Like, we'll kind of talk around it. We've seen the movie. It's been out for a few days now. You got to watch it, but we'll just talk about some of our favorite elements of it. Sorry, Elise, go ahead.
No, like Fredo was saying, this movie really does lean into showing you every graphic moment. Like, it's not pulling any punches when it comes to the gore or fatalities, which is really fun, if I'm being honest. Like, it's just kind of way over the top in an almost like cartoonish way.
Yeah, I appreciate that it knows what it is, and it's like it's paying respect to the source material, which is just a really bloody, over the top, like violent video game. And this is a very like violent, crazy movie, because like, we'll talk about 95 Mortal Kombat, but a thing that did is it didn't really film fighting very well, but this movie like pulls the camera back and you can see everything that's going on. It's nice.
And that was a thing that was big for a long, long time where, I mean, just piggybacking off of what Blaine was saying, those fight scenes that were just so zoomed in, you just see fists flying here and there. And just like, I really wanted, you know, this movie, and they did it. They pulled back the camera so you could see these long choreographed fights clear as day. And it wasn't just like, oh, they're fighting. You know what I mean? You hear punching noises and you see fists and feet kicking around. So I'm happy that they did that.
Especially when you're dealing with some of these, you know, fighters in the universe that have powers, and like you want to see Sub-Zero specifically ice somebody, and you're going to get that like in the full scope of it. And the effects are like that comprehensive that you get that.
There's something about, I don't know what it is about Mortal Kombat, but like when you see a character get introduced, it's so hype for some reason. You know what I mean? Like, you see a character jump on screen, it's like, oh, that's Kung Lao, yeah! Oh! It's so exciting. It's like, I don't get it. It's so exciting.
It's like wrestling. There's like elements of it where it's like, oh, that's my favorite wrestler.
Yeah.
It's the guy that wears the yellow and he's got the things that he throws and says, get over here. Like, he's my favorite. Like, yeah, that's what Mortal Kombat brings.
Like, yeah, and entrance. Like everybody comes from like a different order or clan, or there's some kind of lore behind where they're coming from, the relationships, you know, like, whether it's like Liu Kang and his cousin. Like, it's like there's everybody's got some kind of backstory or grudge, or, you know, just a motivation that's like really, really fun.
A couple of things that I did really, really like about the movie is that, one, you can understand that and see that they knew the lore, right? They weren't just like, all right, let's just, hey, Mortal Kombat movie, you know, people know Mortal Kombat. It's like you really understood that they did their research. But on the flip side of that is that they did take their own liberty with some of these things. Like the fact that, you know, it was Sub-Zero that, you know, essentially broke Jax's arms. Like, usually it's Ermac, right? So it was cool that they were like, okay, we're going to break Jax's arms again because that's what happens, but we're going to have Sub-Zero do it this time.
Well,
so that was really, really cool.
They do something really fun with Jax and his arms in this, like, to vaguely, you know, hint at it. There's a really fun progression with Jax and his arms.
Yeah,
I'll say no
it's
more.
Like, it's like super beefed up.
Just talk about how good Kano was in this movie as just like a comic relief character.
Yes, and I do love Kano from the OG 95. Like, but then the fun thing about Kano is I feel like his origin is always nebulous. Like, is he British? Is he Australian? Like, where is this man? And that's something that I think the universe has played with over the years. But in this one, no, it's he's Australian. He's definitively Australian.
I feel like you could watch any Mortal Kombat movie that has Kano in it, and you just know that guy smells probably like really bad. He's just like, he's just a gross dude, but you hate to, you love to hate him.
Yeah, it's like, where's that eye been?
We'll get into 95 Kano later, but I mean, this Kano didn't have the 95 drool that Kano had. Like 95 Kano,
bro,
you could tell that you just wet if you were talking to him in a scene.
But we'll there's get like to. A scene where, yeah. I'm going to talk about right? Kano's yeah, we'll get to that. Going back to what you were saying, Alfredo, though, like I appreciate that they went into this and they're like, listen, we're not going to be going to the Oscars with this. It's not going to be the next Citizen Kane. It's a Mortal Kombat movie, so let's have some fun. And like, you can, it like seeps through on the screen. Like, you can tell that that was a fun set to be on. They're like kicking each other's asses, goofing around. There's probably like a bunch of improv stuff from like Kano and stuff, and it's just like, I can appreciate that. Like, it's just a fun video game movie, and it's really well done too. Like, there's like actual fighters that are in this kicking each other's asses in real life.
And I don't know, I just felt like it was very true to the franchise. You know, there was a lot of jokes that were, you know, in the movie, I don't want to spoil any of them, that just made you go, oh, okay, like that's an obvious one. But there were also little ones where I was like, oh, that's a reference to the game. Like, that's a funny reference to the game. That's really, really funny. And then also, aside from that, the movesets, right? It was very on point. Like, these Mortal Kombat has been around for a very long time, and there's what? They're on Mortal Kombat 11 in terms of the video game. There's how many? You know, there's a couple other movies. There's a handful of animated series, and there's cartoons. 80 characters. You know, there's like 80 characters in the roster. We'll get to that in a second. But like, it was just really cool to be like, okay, yep, that's what Kung Lao does. That's what Liu Kang does. Like, okay, like Sub-Zero's doing Sub-Zero things. It was really cool to just see that and just go, okay, this was fun. If I'm just like, right, because the new character kind of is that catalyst for people that are new to the franchise, Cole, you know, we're just like, okay, he's the person that's just like, oh, I'm new to this whole
he's your entry point
thing. Yeah, he's your entry point. And then so it's like that, there's that vehicle for people who aren't really immersed into Mortal Kombat and the lore in the franchise. And then if you are in any way, shape or form, there's, it trickles, right? There's different levels of like, oh, okay, like I kind of know Mortal Kombat, that I get that.
Yeah. There were some characters that showed up that I didn't recognize. But I was like, oh, this is a cool, and it actually, oh man, I wish we could talk spoilers, because there's one fatality that like was my favorite fatality, and it totally flipped this one character's you know, what you think is their power against them. And I really like that.
I want people to leave in the comments what fatality you think Elise is talking about.
Please.
I just appreciate Sub-Zero. I just like, this is like, I've always been a Scorpion man, and this movie really challenged me because it made Sub-Zero basically like Terminator, Predator, and Vader all in one. Like, the guy was like unstoppable. He was scary. He had like cool breathing, didn't say much, just like turned stuff to ice with his superpowers. Like, this is a Sub-Zero standout film for me, and that's coming from Camp Scorpion, so, ugh.
Yeah.
Oh, can we just take a minute and just...
Thanks. I know. That took a lot to say that. I know I'm very brave for saying that. Yeah.
No, I agree. He was threatening.
I mean, like, in the other thing, too, and you can see all this stuff in the trailer, but, like, the visual effects, like, when Jax shoots the shotgun and he freezes the bullets in midair.
So
like,
cool.
That looks real. Like, the way that the light is trickling out of from the ice and stuff and like the pellets, like, yeah, it's pretty crazy.
I think for me, I did like Melina a lot. It was weird because it was almost like they did her in a more realistic way. Like,
yeah.
Here's if Melina really existed in life. This is what her weird, you know,
mouth
like fanged mouth would look like. But I thought she was like just, you know, super imposing anytime she was on screen.
I mean, being a Scorpion man who is also now a fan of Sub-Zero but also a big Kano guy, I gotta give to Jax. Sorry, very complicated, right. Long answer, but like, there's just something
I had it and I never had it.
Giant like metal leaps. Biceps. I mean, the guy's huge. He's got the beautiful mustache. So I got to go with Jax. It's a simple and recognizable design. You see that guy from 100 yards away, and you're like, ah, it's Jax.
I think, you know, obviously, for me, Scorpion is an obvious answer for a lot of people. I dressed up as Scorpion like 3 Halloween straight when I was younger. but one of the things that was really cool is that, especially with Mortal Kombat, like I was saying, is a roster of like 80 characters now. You never know who's going to pop up. And this was in one of the like other trailers that they showed. And I was very happy with the design. It was really cool to see them on screen. Was Cabal. I thought Cabal was super cool.
Oh, yeah.
And it was just like, oh, Cabal's in this movie. Like, that's awesome. There's so many other characters that I thought would be brought to the big screen for the first Mortal Kombat movie, you know, in this day and age. And Cabal wasn't one of them. And I thought that he played so well to the new way, you know, the new age of like visual effects.
So, yeah, new Mortal Kombat's out now. It's a hell of a time. It made me question my love for Scorpion in favor of Sub-Zero, which is very problematic for me.
All right. So now let's get into the OG Mortal Kombat, okay? It was the movie that proved that games could be a hit on the big screen. It's kind of like the 1989 Batman movie, the one that kicked in the door for everything that came afterward. Mortal Kombat managed to straddle the line between being a fun action movie that didn't take itself super seriously and a pretty good one at that. Oh, let's not forget that killer soundtrack, that intro with the fire and the flames. It was one of the first video game movies to be a legit box office hit, spending 3 weeks at the top of the U.S. box office at that.
Fredo, that soundtrack went platinum in like 2 weeks.
Dude, and it's not just the theme song. There's like a song where Liu Kang's walking up to the temple and it's a bop. Like, it's just like every song in that movie is like, I could bench press a house right now. I feel so pumped up.
This movie slaps in every aspect. I can't say it enough. It was my first experience with Mortal Kombat as a kid because I hadn't played the game, but then I saw the movie first and was just kind of like mind blown. And seeing Bridget Wilson-Sampras in this, who plays Sonya Blade, I thought she was super cool. That fight with Kano, which is maybe one of my top 3 favorite moments in the movie.
She has a really good voice for like fighting emotions. Like that part where she like get, I think it was like Kano like backhands her and she's like,
and I'm just like, guttural. He kicks her. He kicks her in the stomach and she's like, and then you feel it in your heart. Yeah.
I'm just like, dude. Oh man, her facial emotions when she's fighting Kano and Kano's just spitting and drooling everywhere. And I'm just like, how do you fight? Man, that's dirty fighting, Kano. What are you doing out here?
Dude, I mean, like, come on, Sonya. And he's just like spitting on her legs. There's like dribbles of spit. It's like, god dang, Kano. Chill, bro.
Here's a question. Is he saying from ear to ear or here to here? From ear?
I thought it was.
I still don't know.
Yeah.
I think it's ear, but I don't know.
I mean, if we're talking this movie, everyone's getting introduced to the tournament and everything like that. But man, when they go down to the bottom of that ship and Sonya, you know, Liu Kang and Johnny Cage are there and Shang Tsung is there and he gives them a little taste and you see Sub-Zero and Scorpion open that door and walk out. Oh my god, it's so good.
The ninja costumes. And another thing that I forgot too is like I was always hyped on the ninjas because like in the game, it's the same sprite and they just color the pads differently. And I totally forgot the reptile fight scene that was at the end. And it's the green ninja. And I was like, oh my god, like I'm a dumb kid who just sees colors. And that's so cool to me. There's these same ninja dudes with different colors and powers.
And in terms of great 90s CG, it's got, you know, Reptile falling into the statue and then melding with it and transforming to his human form. It was like, it's so great.
I will say seeing like Reptile, I was like, oh man, why they do Reptile dirty like that? Why did they have to make Reptile look like that? Right? Like it just like hunched over and like, high pitched. And then I was like, oh man, they did Reptile so dirty.
No,
but then when the way, man, when like Liu Kang and Johnny Cage went to Outworld and then Liu Kang is just like, grabs Reptile and throws him, like at least saying into that statue.
Yeah.
And then it like engulfs Reptile. And then all of a sudden, like it transforms into the Green Ninja and it's like Reptile. And then like another bop starts playing. I'm like, let's go.
Yeah. This movie was exactly what it needed to be. It was exactly what it needed to be. And we owe it.
I think my favorite and the thing that always sticks out to me is the most nostalgic moment is whenever Shang Tsung says, "Your soul is mine."
Like,
I quoted that way too often and way too comfortably as a child. Like, I would say that to anybody, like a dog.
Your church youth group.
Church, they'd be talking about Jesus taking your soul and it'd be like, "Your soul is mine.
Soul is mine." And you can see, like he's just like bringing it from like the chest to the throat and out. It's like, "Your soul." It's like, whoa.
Best body, best physique goes to Goro, hands down. Not a question.
Goals.
The movie is such a fun progression of getting you excited for Goro to fight one of you know, the Earth Realm challengers. Like, he's at the big dinner table and he's just being Goro. We see him kind of just wrecking his way through just a slew of fighters. And there is no one better to fight him than Johnny Cage.
Well, you just said that the movie makes you excited to see Goro. Goro gets you excited to see Goro. Because The entire time, he's got his forearms in the air going, just screaming at everybody. It's like, we get it, Goro. You're hyped, dude.
And just when he's like, when Kano's sitting there slobbing all over the whatever, I don't know, I guess a
turkey chicken, leg.
Turkey leg or something. Yeah. That thing was huge. And he's like, "I am Prince Goro." And I'm like, "Oh, damn. I do not want to fight Goro." Like, hell no, man. Like, look at that guy.
That was the other thing, too, is like they do a great job of setting up the characters, like in the beginning, like when you're introduced to all of them. Like, you see Sonya being the worst mosh pit participant ever. She's like, hitting people with the butt of her shotgun. You're like, "Damn, Sonya, chill, dude."
Oh, that's what I was saying. I was like, "You're looking for Kano, not trying to, you know, do a drug bust on this place or anything like that, or shut it down."
She's bringing
like,
a bunch
"Get
of ravers
out of my way," like, just ravers getting bashed in the head. And I was like, "That's nuts."
Yeah, but no, I think the best entrance is Johnny Cage. Like, Johnny Cage is, I think, the hero of this movie through and through. Like, when he walks in and the doors open up and he's like, "Let's dance." Like, dude, so
he's
cool.
So good.
It's still, I watched it a week ago. It's still fun. It's still super hyped. Even had like Ed Boon like voicing Scorpion, right? Like he was the one that voiced Scorpion in the original.
Which is such
along
a fun
with, like,
touch.
Other characters like Jax, and you know, he's in this movie voicing Scorpion. So when you hear him in the woods fighting Johnny and just like, "Oh, that sounds just like Scorpion from the video game." It's like, "Oh, okay, now I know why."
And if you don't know Ed Boon, he's the creator of Mortal Kombat.
That he is.
Which makes it all the cooler.
I think the scene in the forest was a pickup. Like, that wasn't in the original cut. And they were like, "Oh, we got to have another Johnny Cage scene." So they just went and filmed that. Because it's so random. Like, there's the tournaments going on. And then Johnny Cage is out for a walk. And then he runs into Scorpion in the woods. And then they're just like, "I guess we got to kill each other."
Yeah. And the fun thing about that fight is, like, what I always appreciate is where you have these, like, you know, just humans that don't have superpowers per se. And it's like, how do they fight against fighters that do? And so it's like Johnny Cage being like, "Okay, well, I got to use the trees to my advantage here."
I just want to hear like Ed Boon as Scorpion talking more, because it was just so, I don't know why, but it was just so cool. Instead of just hearing like, "Get over here," like all the other things he'd say, he was like, "Welcome, get down here." And I was like, "Just talk to me, Scorpion. What's up? Like, let me know. Where do you want me to go? Where are we going next?" Like,
I feel comfortable talking about spoilers for this almost 30-year-old movie. So we would be remiss if we didn't talk about the end of this film, which is amazing because, you know, they get like it's, you know, Liu Kang and Johnny Cage and Sonya and Katana and Raiden. They all get back to the Shaolin Temple and we think like, you know, okay, everything's all good. The children are playing, they're running, everybody. It's things are good again. All of a sudden, Psych, the biggest 90s Psych ever, which is the Outworld Emperor, just like is giant and just. Yeah, comes out of the sky and is like, you know, "I'm here for not if you know, Shang Tsung was coming for your soul, I'm here for everybody's soul." And then they all kind of do this like just fight stance freeze frame thing. And it is the coolest end ever. It's great.
Yeah. No, it's your hype start to finish. You're just like, "Yeah, all right, let's go."
Like, just a good time, man. I don't know. Just something about that movie. It was just so fun. It's so fun during the time, and then watching it a week back, I was just, I don't know. It's just so fun. Yeah.
And of course, after Mortal Kombat 1995, we got a follow-up in a sequel, 1997's Mortal Kombat Annihilation, which takes place immediately after the ending of the 95 one.
And like seconds after. Yeah.
Seconds after. And like I said, like Liu Kang, Raiden, Jax, Sonya, Katana. I think Jax is here now. And now they're like, okay, well, Shao Kahn is here and he's trying to merge Earth with the outworld realm. And there is a bit of a system shock. If you are, you know, 9-year-old Elise watching this movie and you boot up Annihilation, and then you do realize that a lot of the actors are different.
Johnny
know.
Cage, who needs him? Let's kill that exactly. The most coolest character off.
They did Johnny so dirty right off the bat in the beginning of the film.
You know, saving grace of Annihilation, we got more Jax, which we didn't really get much Jax.
He had about 2 minutes of screen time in the original, and now we get a whole lot more in his sleeveless jacket that he leaves. He might as well not be wearing.
Yeah.
It's just...
Jax's arms looked almost comically large, though. They were like, I don't know, they're like really fluffed up, those like cybernetic arms. It was cool though, seeing characters like Cyrax, like mm-hmm. that was awesome. I was like, okay, like now we're getting into, you know, all the cybernetic and technological advancements in the that's in like the Mortal Kombat lore too as well. So I was like, all right,
we're not gonna pretend that this is like the Casablanca of video game movies. Like, it's not a great movie by any means, but it does have a full roster, that's for sure. Like, you get, like, basically every character from the game in some way, form, or another.
Yeah, it's, like, 90s fun. It's still 90s fun. We can say that. This movie is still 90s fun. And like you were saying, Fredo, you were excited that Cabal was, you know, in the new movie. You even just get, like, a Cabal mention in this. You get some characters that they just get a shout out, and it's like, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, for, the like, the big fans, you're getting that little bit of a sprinkle. Just a sprinkle.
A lot of characters come and go very fast in Annihilation, but
almost too many characters.
It's almost too many characters that come and go. But I mean, it was still cool, like seeing even more characters get involved in, you know, more combat on the big screen. You know, surprisingly enough, I didn't think that they'd get into animality. Like,
yeah, they got that into
was.
That.
I was like, oh, we are going there. Okay.
Oh yeah, the cutting edge visual effects. Oh. Whoa, that final fight floored me. And you mentioned earlier that you wanted to hear more of Scorpion talking. He has such hits as "suckers," like he just
yeah, he
kidnaps someone. He just kidnaps says, Katana. Suckers.
He's fighting against Sub-Zero's brother, and yeah, and then yeah, just grabs Katana, just teleports. Suckers!
Gone. Like, I want him to do what? My GPS so bad.
Yeah, that movie definitely was something.
Yeah, I think that Mortal Kombat Annihilation, for what it did right, what it did wrong, was a blueprint for, like, you know, future Mortal Kombat movies, you know, what kind of to improve on and what the fan base wants and doesn't want. And, you know, how far you can kind of push this franchise and, you know, those hits and mitts. And I do think that we definitely see in the 2021 remake reboot. We see that, you know, okay, you listened. You definitely learned from the lessons of the yeah. past.
And they also made it to where it wasn't a confusing title that 7-year-old Blaine couldn't totally mess
couldn't
up.
Because
for yeah. for years, the longest time, I thought it was Mortal Kombat Annihilation. Annihilation. I was not a smart child. But I did love Mortal Kombat movies.
It did have a couple of things that were cool. You know what I mean? Liu Kang's animality, you know, that was, you know, biting off, turning into a dragon and biting off the top half of an opponent's body.
But if I was Sonya, I'd be like, dude, where was that in our last movie? Like, you could have used that dragon biting head off
thing. Yeah, we could have just taken that tournament one fell swoop.
Also, I'm looking at a fact sheet, and it looks like if you add up all the back flips, front flips, and side flips, there are 54 total flips in the movie. Gosh. That's a
so
lot.
So disorienting.
There's a scene where they're getting like surrounded by the bad guys, and it's just like they're just flips. Flipping. They're just doing flips over and over. It's like, all right, we get it. You're here. So, yes, there is a slew of Mortal Kombat films. You have the 95 one. You got the new one out, which is also a banger. And you got Annihilation, if you want to watch the two. Fortunately, there's also a really good cartoon called Mortal Kombat Legends Scorpion's Revenge. And it is everything the game is, but in cartoon form, because it is like hilariously violent. Like it is yes. over the top.
Yeah, it's more of that good revenge cartoon violence that we've come to know and expect from Hanzo Hasashi.
Yeah, dude, they're two clans just going at it. It's just at this point, it's just so iconic. You know what I mean? Where it went from like growing up as a person that watched the movie and then tried to play the video games poorly. I was like, oh my goodness, yellow ninja versus blue ninja. And now it's like Sub-Zero versus Scorpion. And I'm just like, oh, okay, Hanzo versus Sub-Zero's clan. And like now I'm starting to understand like more between these two iconic characters. And It was brutal. I mean, because it's animated, right? You could really go over the top with it. But there's like, they very much pull no punches, which is nice. It's animated, which lends very well into Mortal Kombat and the brutality of the series. But it was also a little bit goofy. I know, you know, in the first fight scene, Hanzo like stabs someone and then his eyes are just like plopping and dangling out. It looked very goofy, like googly eyes. You know
what I mean? It's like cartoon violence. And even, I mean, I feel like I've seen some pretty violent anime, but this, as far as 2D animation goes, is pretty gory.
Oh yeah, it's crazy gory. Yeah, I mean it's Warner Brothers Animation, so they've been making a bunch of like awesome superhero films and Justice League movies and like, you know, Titans and stuff like that, like all that good stuff. But then they were just like, listen, superheroes just don't bleed enough. We need to have more blood and guts and brains and X-ray vision of a guy getting a sword cut through his spine. Like it's just like, oh my god.
Yeah, there's
god.
Like literally vivisection that you're seeing in some of these like fight scenes when you're like, okay, there's the spine, there's the liver, there's the kidneys, there's the heart. I mean, they're showing me everything.
They have like some people on staff that are probably like anatomy experts, you know, like they like went have a doctorate in the human body.
I bet if you're an animator working on this show, it's a dream because you're kind of like using all of that human form study that I'm sure you did. You're like, okay, now I'm literally drawing a skeleton.
No, it's good stuff. And there's like, it's got the whole roster, you know, you got your Johnny Cages and your Sonyas and stuff like that. Like there's like a lot of elements of, I think that they figured out like the best stuff from all of the different movies, films and cartoons that they've made over the years. And then they just put it into this one because it's, you know, you got your jerk Johnny Cage and you're like ass kicking Sonya Blades.
It's exhausting in a good way. Because, I mean, like, right off the bat, you know, Hanzo is just tearing through an absurd amount of the Lin Kuei. Like, an obscene amount. Just guts, blood everywhere. And they just keep throwing more bodies at Hanzo.
Yes.
And at the end of it, he's like, and I'm sitting here just like, oh, God, man, that's so much blood. How you that's a lot. How you still functioning right now? And so, like, it's exhausting in a good way. And it's cool because, I mean, you could do this, you know what I mean, in a live action film, and they kind of do that in the beginning of the Mortal Kombat movie that was just released, but it's just so over the top because it's animated in a good way.
And it's got our main dude Goro in it as well. Who doesn't love more Goro? Just going, ah! All right, so that pretty much wraps up our little history lesson in Mortal Kombat. You know, it's had an awesome history, both on the big and the little screen. And the new movie that's coming out, it's pretty sick. You should check it out.
Yeah, that brings us to the end of our second episode. You can catch Popcorn and Shield with all of us every other week on Fridays right here on the Warner Brothers Entertainment Channel. Be sure to subscribe and we'll notify you of new episodes. Also, be sure to check out the other content on the channel. There's tons of behind-the-scenes content and first looks that you should definitely get a glimpse at.
And don't forget, on the next episode, we are talking about the Batman animated series. My goodness, this was Batman for a lot of us growing up. We're all big fans. It's the Batman animated series. Come on, it speaks for itself. We're going to be talking about that. We're also going to be talking about other films like Batman Long Halloween. With that being said, that's Blaine. That's Lise. I'm Alfredo. Thank you so much for joining us, and we'll see you next time.
Get over here! Get down here! Finish him! Welcome! Fatality!
Your soul is mine.